Here we go. No, I will pick this all up eventually.
Oh, yeah, a packet.
Have a seat.
Something that's going to start happening in the next couple of weeks, and you're going to start to register for classes for next year. Okay, so what will happen is you might have a little meeting with your counselor or as a group somehow, and you'll start having to register for classes. So this class is called CP Algebra 1, okay? And there's basically two choices for you to go with. Now, if your first semester grade was an A, I am very happy to say go to CP Accelerated Geometry. If your grade was a B, a C, or a D, then you go to just CP Geometry, which is the same lineage as this. And if you were unfortunate to be this person, which we didn't have anybody, you need to repeat CP Algebra 1. Okay, so that's basically what we do. Things to note, our history shows this. We track a lot of data here at this school. Students that make this leap to here, and we only give the student who earned an A that choice to think about, is going to earn 7 to 8% lower as far as what our data shows if they choose to go with the accelerated path, which is our middle path, okay? So if you are a student that doesn't guarantee that you would earn 7 to 8% less, I've seen students who have gone from CP Algebra 1 to here and they are right in line where they used to earn. It's just that with all the students that have done it, it's about 7 or 8% lower grade as far as that. So if you were like a 90%, are you willing to get the B? Okay? If you're a 98%, 99%, 97%, you should probably right there. So this is what I would sign you off on if you wanted to go that way. And that's a conversation I will have with you once you get your sheets for registration. Typically, our data shows that students here will earn 2 to 3% less, and it's just the nature of how math works. And then I don't have any data here, and this doesn't apply to any of you, so let's not even worry about that. So those are just a few things for you all to start thinking about for next school year and what you want to do. I do teach this class. I have two sections of it this year. It's a great class. It has a great thought process that goes with it. This is also a great class. This one has a lot of proofs, which a proof is where you show your logical progression of events through telling us the rules that apply in order to make this leap to this leap to this leap to this leap. It, you know, a lot of people say proofs are horrific, they're horrible. They are not. A proof is done. It's a way of thinking. It's a way of having you go through a set of problems. It's how a doctor actually goes through something called a differential diagnosis, which is what each and every one of you have ever been to a doctor. You have gone through some sort of differential diagnosis, even if you've gone in just for a physical. Okay, it's where they go through and they try to eliminate things that aren't and then apply the things that are. You've gone in with like some sort of viral infection or something like that. If you've gone with an ear infection, you know, a doctor's not going to say, oh, you have an ear, you know, your ears hurt. Oh, well, you know, you might have an ingrown toenail. You know, they're not going to be that. They go through a thought process that's very much the same as a mathematical proof. The proofs that you do here are much shorter, but it still gives you the thought process of going through. But geometry is an awesome class. I really enjoy teaching it. I don't know what I'm teaching next year. I'm I'm always the guy that says, hey, whatever you have left, I'm happy to take. I don't claim ownership to any types of classes. So that's just me as a teacher. And that's what I've always done my whole career. So this is just for you all to think about for next year, okay? Any questions on any of those? Cool. So again, you'll start seeing the information coming out to you in the next couple of weeks for registration. And there's things that us teachers sign off for you guys in order to take stuff. All right, so we are on word problems day two, correct? This is what I wanted you all to work on last night. And again, I will eventually be picking up, as a packet, I will pick up worksheet number 7, number 8A, which is what we did today, 8B, which will be tonight, and worksheet 9, which will be Friday. And then on worksheet 10, this will be assigned on Monday night. So on Tuesday of next week, I want 1, 2, 3, 4, all 5 of these pages. They will be stapled, put together, and you'll submit that. It'll be worth 4 points, but I'll make it worth a scale factor of 5, because 5 times 4 is, or actually I make a scale factor of 5, so 4 times the 5 assignments would still look, makes it look like 4, but it's worth actually the 5 assignments. Make sense? So you want to make sure they are done. So if you're getting them done, awesome. If you're not getting them done, make sure you are filling in what we have in class, and of course the videos are recorded for all of you. Okay, so we're at the very first question about this lawn mowing scenario and shoveling. So it says, last year, you mowed lawns and shoveled snow for 10 households. You charged $200 a season to mow the lawn and $180 a season to shovel snow. You earned $1,880 last year. How many households did you mow the lawn for? How many did you shovel snow for? Okay, so if we start getting numbers that are above 10, you made a mistake. Why do I say that?
Because you
shoveled 10. Yeah, it was a total of 10 homes that you either shoveled or did snow removal, or maybe a combination of both. But if you came up, so please be aware, you know, when you're reading this problem, okay, keep in the back of your mind, I can't get numbers bigger than 10. As far as when they're asking how many households did this or that, because there was only 10 homes that I dealt with. So lawn, we will call L for a variable. And then snow, we'll call X. I'm just kidding, we'll call S. Okay? So you mowed lawns or shoveled snow for 10 households. You charged $200 a season to do what? So $200 for the lawns plus $180 for what?
Snow.
How much did you make?
$1,880.
Okay. That seems like an okay little business you got going. All right. So how do we figure out another equation?
There's 10 houses.
10 houses? Okay, so it's going to be 10 houses, so lawns plus snow. Do I need to put a number in front of those? No, it's just, and it appears that we did lawns or shoveled for 10 households. Okay? So let's see how this works out. It says, if you earned that much, how many households did you mow the lawn for? How many did you shovel snow for?
Okay.
I think how it's set up, we are set to probably do elimination. Now, one thing I want to show you is I can modify that top equation a little bit. 200, 180, and 1880 are bigger numbers. If we were going to do elimination, we might choose to get rid of lawns, where we'd have to multiply the whole bottom by negative 200, which is fine, but the numbers are getting bigger. So one thing that you could do, if you'd like, you can divide everything on the very top equation by 10. That would give you 20L plus 18S equals 1888, or 188. Okay? But you don't have to do it that way. If that's too much to think, oh, I don't want to think that much, well, then you say, okay, well, let's get rid of, let's multiply everything here by negative 200. Why am I choosing negative 200, not just 200?
Because you're trying to eliminate it.
Yeah, I want an opposite sign. So I'm going to distribute negative 200 here and here and here. So I have negative 200L plus negative 200S, or I could have had just minus S, equals negative 2,000. So if I add these two equations together, what's falling out? What's falling out? The L's are gone, so I get negative 20S. Oh, that's kind of weird. I got a negative answer there. Well, maybe I'll get a negative on the other. That'll cancel it out. 1880 minus 2,000, I get negative what? How much? 120. Cool. Oh, cool. So now if I go negative divided by negative, I'm going to get positive. So what does that come out to? Six? What does six represent? Six homes were snow. And being I dealt with 10 households, how many were lawn? Lawn was four. Now, I know the question that may come, might be coming to mind going, well, you know, did you do lawn and snow for, you know, did one of those houses require both? I don't know. Our problem wasn't set up to do that. Our problem was to set up to know that of these 10 houses that were on our street that we were going to deal with, or in our neighborhood that we're going to deal with, there were six of those homes that chose to have us deal with snow removal, and there was four of them that had us deal with the lawn service. Okay? Could one of those homes had both lawn and snow? Yeah, but right now I'm showing that I had four customers during the summer and six customers during the winter, and I was only dealing with the 10 homes in my neighborhood. And it's very possible that one home had me just deal with, you know, the lawns, and then, or four of the homes had the lawns only, and then six of those homes, six different homes, had the snow removal, but it could have been a combination. It's just we don't have all that information. But that's exactly how we set up that problem. Do I have it set up as an ordered pair? Do I have the answer as 4, 6? It's up to you if you want to go that way. Okay, but this one is identifying what our two variables are. Make sense? Our answers aren't bigger than 10, which we said in the beginning couldn't happen, and it worked out nicely. May I move off that problem, or is there any questions there? Okay. Oh, boy. I always hated when I went on family trips. I liked when my dad drove. I didn't like when my mom drove. Because you know what? Dad broke the speed limit a lot. And I thought that was cool. Now, you know, when I drive on our family trips, I try and break the speed limit. But my co-pilot, a.k.a. my wife, she's bad. Because you know what she does? She programs in that if it goes over the speed limit, that the GPS thing starts beeping. So not only do I have this co-pilot, but I get this, you know, government-controlled computer telling me that I'm going too fast. Oh, it's horrible. Oh, it's horrible. Although I like when I go to Texas. Not because I like the fact that Texas is a wonderful state. It's just that Texas has an 85-mile-an-hour speed limit posted on I-10. And my wife's like, shouldn't be going that fast. That's what the speed limit says. Heck yeah, I'm doing 85. Heck, I'm going to 90. I can turn the GPS warning mechanism off. I'm going to 100. I remember when Mom would drive. Oh, Dad, come on, don't let You drive. Get home faster that way.
Okay, but anyhow, here's our word problem of this for number two. Your mother and father took turns driving on a 580-mile trip that took 10 hours to complete. Oh, boy. Your mother always drives 55 miles per hour, and your father always drives 60 miles per hour. Boy, you got a lead-footed father there. How long did it take? Did each of them drive? Use a system of equations to solve. Okay? All right. So, let's do this. Mom will use M. Make sense? Dad will use D. Those are our variables. So, how long did this trip take?
Just 1 hour.
10 hours. So between mom and dad's driving habits, it took us 10 hours to get to this location. You with me on this? Mom drove a whopping 55. Dad drove a whopping 60. How far in distance? Oh, whoa, 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 you're right. Hey, time out. Thank you.
Oh, jeez. Got the calligraphy pen up there now.
All right. How many miles was it?
580 miles. All right, that's not too far.
That's a little further than here to Albuquerque, right? It's like from here to Gallup if you take 25 and then you go over on 40. Gallup, New Mexico. Any of you ever been to Gallup? It's pretty with the Red Rocks. We used to hot air balloon there once a year, which, you know, hot air ballooning amongst the Red Rocks is pretty cool. But boy, no matter what hotel you stay at, Gallup, it's close to the railroad tracks. Mm-hmm. And I swear there is like 19 trains that go through in the middle of the night, and all you hear is, and you're like, Dad, I can't sleep. It's a train. Try and go to sleep. All right. We need to solve for M, and we need to solve for D. So, there's our two equations. I think it would make sense to try and get rid of the dad, in this case. Why do I say that? It could be either or, but why do I feel the dad might be the easier one to go with? I'm multiplying by what? Yeah, so I'm multiplying by 60 versus 55, right? Is it really that tough either way? I don't know. But sometimes multiplying by a two-digit number where one of the numbers happens to be zero might be good. What else do I need that 60 to be?
Negative.
Negative? Okay. All right, so negative 60 is all distributed here and to here and to here. So I get negative 60m plus negative 60d, right? Is negative 600. All right, so we're going to combine these two together, correct? Does that all make sense? So what do I get here with the mom? Negative 5m. Okay. What about the dad? They cancel. What about with our numbers? Negative 20. All right, so mom drove 4 of the hours. The whole trip took 10 hours. How much did Dad drive?
6 hours.
6 hours. Yes. Does it make sense? If Dad drove 6 hours, Mom drove 4 hours, that it took 10 hours to get to someplace?
Yep.
Sure. My parents had this lady, her name was Joyce. She used to drive my sister and I places after school because she was retired and my mom and dad worked full time, so. But boy, oh, she was the worst driver. Oh, it's scary. So not only was she like, you know, she would wait till the last second to brake, or she would take the turn way too fast, but she was the driver who didn't realize that you could find a common place on your gas pedal to go a constant rate of speed. So you'd watch the speedometer go up to 55, then down to 40, then to 55, and then down to 40. And you'd be like, ooh. Ooh. And you'd get to your location going, I think I'm going to barf.
My dad does that so much.
Oh, it's horrible. It's horrible. Boy.
Right.
Old Joyce, she didn't know how to drive, but save her life. I mean, I always got the location okay. I always felt sick. And I remember time I asked my sister. She said my sister had actually one time she had asked her to pull over to the side of the road because my sister vomited because she got so car sick with how this woman drove. So I thought that was kind of a good thing. Joyce, yeah, rest her soul. She passed away many years ago. Movies. I like the movies. Movie theater tickets cost $10 for an adult, $6 per child. One group purchased 12 tickets for a total of $84. How many adult and how many child tickets were purchased? Okay, so for adult, I think it would make sense that we'd use the letter A. For child, I think we should use the letter
Z.
Yeah, you with me on that? All right.
Yeah.
Hey, how many tickets were purchased total?
12.
So between the adults and the children, there were 12 tickets that were purchased for this event. You with me so far? Hey, how much did the adult ticket cost? So $10 for every adult ticket. And how much was each child?
$6
for every child. How much was the total bill? $84. Okay. So we have our two equations set up pretty easily right there, huh? What letter looks like it'd be okay to solve for?
C.
Okay, let's get rid of the C. That works. I would have probably chose the adult because I could multiply by 10, but I'll multiply it. Get rid of the C. So I'll multiply everything by 6 or?
Negative
6. Okay, I'll distribute here, here, and here. Take a negative 6A minus 6C. And then negative 6 times 12. What is 6 times 12?
72.
72? Okay. Oh, 79. I can't write. All right, so we're going to combine these both together. What do you think? So 10A added to negative 6A, we get what?
4A.
Is it negative 4A or just positive 4A? It's positive, right? All right, that happens. Our C's cancel out. And then what do we get if we go 84 minus 72?
12.
12. So how many adults are at this event?
Three.
How many tickets did we sell?
12.
12. Adults took up 3 of those, so how many were the children?
9.
So to this day of the movies, there were 3 adults and 9 kids. Hope it was a good movie. Hope the kids behaved. Hope the adults behave too.
Adults get silly.
Oh boy.
Call me a driver and you get drunk.
That's why I like going to the Alamo movie theater. I don't know if y'all been there or not. You use your cell phone during the movie, kicked out.
Really?
No. Seriously? Refund. Hold
on.
Where is it?
No refund.
That on Santa Fe Mineral. No refund. No. They totally warn you. You talk during the movie, ejected.
Dude, I wish.
Like, it's the greatest place on earth. I mean, because you're, in my opinion, because if I go to a movie, one, I don't need to hear the conversation behind me, because I don't care about it. I care about the movie. I paid to be there at the movie. I didn't care that Bill and Steve hadn't seen each other in 12 years. You know what? Go over to the restaurant and chat about it all day long. That's great. But the Alamo Movie Theater out on Santa Fe in Mineral. Cell phone use? Ejected, talk, ejected. No refund.
How did they enforce that?
You don't have a concession stand there. You have people that are walking around as your waiters. So you have a seat and a seat, and between every two seats is a little table, and there's a little light on the table. So let's say you want to order something, there's a little golf pencil. You write on
the
paper, and you put your thing up here, so the guy will come and he'll grab it. But if you hear someone talking, you do the same thing. It looks like you're making a reverse in. The people right behind me are talking. The guy next to me is using a cell phone. Put that, boom. It's great. I just want to rat people out even though they're not doing something wrong.
That's brilliant.
Yeah, I loved it. You can't show up if the movie has started. You cannot come in late. And it's everything that I envision a movie theater should be. But, every now and then we go to that Elvis theater. Boy, you got people that show up 2/3 of the way in the movie. Hey, what'd we miss?
2/3 of the movie.
Right, you got that person in the jail uniform outside. You're like, what's going on here? Like, it's the first movie I've been able to afford in 50 years.
Yeah, no, I tell you, I'm a big fan of the Alamo though. So if you're getting sick and tired of people in movies who are thinking they're more important than the movie, then the Alamo might be the place for you. Because that's where you'll find me. It's like $1 per ticket, but it's a good place.
They have unlimited popcorn. So.
It is unlimited popcorn, yeah, and sodas too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So you don't get soda in like a restaurant cup. It's a big old 32 ounce, but it's a good place. You been there? It's a good place?
Oh, I used to live over there. So.
Yeah, I like that place. I like it. All right. So that's my plug for movie theaters for you. All right, problem number 4. Now we're changing gears and no longer off of fun stuff. Okay, the perimeter of a rectangle is 42 meters. Hey, what is the perimeter? What is that?
Like the.
Yeah, if I walked around the whole outside of the. Right? Does everyone remember how to find the perimeter of a rectangle? What is the equation? Base time times will find you the. Length times is really the base time side of the same thing. They'll find you the area. The perimeter. How do you find the perimeter?
Width times two plus length times two, so 2L plus 2W.
That's
a big rectangle, by the way.
Yep, 42 meters is the perimeter around, so it's like a garden or something.
42.
It's 4 meters longer than it is wide. What are the dimensions? Okay, so I'm going to draw a picture because I can't really do things. And let's pretend I can draw really a rectangle. That's length, that's width.
There's a shape by top.
That's okay. Okay, so now you're all indoctrinated to always think that the length is always the longer of the sides of a rectangle. And that's because elementary school teachers didn't really know how to teach math. They were reading out of a booklet. Length and width are just variables, okay? The length and width, they could be equal. The length and width, if they're equal, it's called square. But the length can be longer than the width, or the width can be longer than the length. So there's no justification of what they have. Now they're going to give us some more things. So I know you all told me that the perimeter equation is 2W and 2L added together. So they told us that the perimeter itself is actually what? 42. So the distance all the way around is that. So we already have our first equation made up for us, right? Now that we have a relationship between, it is 4 meters longer than it is wide, okay? So let's just call this our longer side, okay? And I know in elementary school learning, L is length, that's longer, okay? But we're just gonna actually decipher that. So we have some sort of relationship that's taking place here. It is 4 meters longer than it is wide. So the length is happened to be 4 meters longer than it is wide. Did I decipher that correctly? Feel good about it?
Yep.
So my first equation is 2L plus 2W equals 42. My other equation is L equals 4 plus W. Substitution is absolutely where I would go with this problem. So I feel that this could be plugged into right here. What do you think? Seem okay? So if I plug it in, we're going to solve for width, and then we'll be able to, you know, figure out what the length was. 4 plus W, that was an L, plus 2W equals 42. Let's distribute. That's 8 plus 2W plus the other 2W equals 42. 8 plus 4W, because 2W and 2W. Subtract the 8 from both sides. So if I subtract 8 from 42, what do I get? 34. Is that right? So our width is 34 over 4, which is 17 over 2. Which would be
8.5.
That makes sense? And the reason I'm taking this to a decimal here is we're talking about a length. So it makes more sense rather than saying how long or what's the dimension in? It's 17 over 2.
that's 8.5. Meters?
Yep.
All right, so we now know the width of this object, of this rectangle, is 8.5 meters. Do I have enough information to find the length? Yeah. Yeah, what am I going to do with that 8.5?
Plug it back in.
What am I looking for? I'm looking for the length. So if I take this here, I plug it here, I'm going to get L equals 4 plus 8.5, which comes out to 12.5 meters. So our length, 12.5 meters, our width, 8.5 meters. Does that feasibly make sense? I think so. What's 12.5 plus 12.5? Or
25.
Okay. And what is 8.5 plus 8.5 or 8.5? 17. Is 17 added to 25? 42.
Yeah.
Yes. It worked out nicely. Last question. A waitress. Oh, okay. Coin problem. We love this stuff. The waitress has a total of 35 quarters and dimes in her pocket. So, waitress reaches in her pocket, says, wow, there's 35 coins here. Oh, look, they all happen to be quarters and dimes. She has $6.50 in these quarters and dimes. How many of each does she have? Okay. Quarters, we will use Q. Dimes, we will use J. D. Right?
Z.
Gotcha. So, waitress pulls out of her pocket, counts how many coins she has, realizes they're all quarters and dimes. How many coins does the waitress have?
35.
Okay, I know that quarters are worth 25 cents, yes? Mm-hmm. And dimes are worth 10 cents. Okay, I could use 0.1 or 0.10, doesn't matter. And how much money does she have?
6.50.
Okay. So, we need to eliminate one of our letters. D seems easier because we're multiplying by 0.10 rather than 0.25. What do you think? Okay. So let's get rid of dimes. So I'm going to multiply this whole top equation by negative 0.10. I'll distribute it here, here, and here. Let's just bring this down here. So negative 0.10 times Q is negative 0.10Q, right? And negative 0.10D is negative plus negative 0.10D. What is negative 0.10 times 35? What is negative 0.10 times 35?
Negative 350,
right? So I can now add these two columns together. So 0.25Q minus 0.10Q. 0.15Q, okay? The dime column is gone. What is 650 minus 350?
$3.
Is that right? Notice I'm keeping the decimals. I'll keep it two decimals because two decimals deal with money. I'm going to divide each side by 0.15. Help me out. What is 3 divided by 0.15?
20?
Is it 0.20 or 20?
20.
20?
Oh, yeah, 20.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. And again, you should use a calculator if you're not sure of it. So that's totally fine. So I happen to have 20 quarters. Does that seem okay with our problem? How many dimes do I have then?
15.
How do I know that? I have 35 total coins, so I happen to have 15 dimes. And would it make sense to for 15 dimes and 20 quarters to give you about $6.50? I think so. How did you figure that? Well, that's $1.50. And 25 times 2 is $5. $1.50 plus $5 is $6.50. Cool. Yeah.
Okay. So
So I took out the quarters.
Okay. Oh, you eliminated the quarters?
And then somehow I got dimes is equal to 6.42.
Okay, you might have just made an error. I'll take a look at it in a few minutes. So that was there. So I would like you all to work on worksheet. And I'm giving you some time. You have worksheet 8B. 8B, which is page 179, 180, and 181. I believe that's what it is. And you have plenty of time to work on this. Guys and girls, I need to tell you this, that I believe our CP Algebra 1 second semester workbooks are in. So our CP Algebra 1 second semester workbooks are in. So they are over in Bare Necessities, and I think it's $5, okay? So if $5 is a problem, they let me know, and we'll make it work the other way. But probably, judging by our pacing of this class, oh, that was almost a good catch. Our pacing of this class, we have, the book is winning. It looks like next Thursday, a week from today, we'll have the test for this. So that means Friday of next week, we start on that new book. So you have until Thursday next week to pick up that book. Sound okay?
So are these pages in that book?
No. No. Okay. So, no, we're still working out of our old book. And we'll be done with that. And then, so Thursday of next week, we have the test on this. So by Thursday next week, you should go over to Bare Necessities and pick up that book. Are there any questions about the homework? Are we good?